Hello and welcome to episode 39 of The Money Talks. And today we have an amazing venturepreneur, entrepreneur, professor, doctor, musician, cricketer, you name it. I think we've required about five episodes just to go through each one of these stories. But I'm super, super excited to have Dr. Srikanth on the show. Dr. Srikanth, welcome.
Thank you. Thank you all. Lovely to meet you. I know these are tough times, but happy to share my journey with you. And I've always kind of looked up to folks like Anirudh, because I think this is where tomorrow is headed. So go ahead, Anirudh. It's your show.
So, Doc, you have a journey that's spanning over 25 years, starting at IIT Madras. Colorado, Illinois, you've been a CEO of a top 100 privately held company in the US. We're going to get through all of this, and we're going to come wind your way back to India and how you ended up becoming a GP at VenturEast. I think there is so much to cover. I'm not even sure 500 minutes is going to be enough, but we're going to try to compress this using some algorithm to get it under 50 minutes. So,
the simplest algorithm is drop the unimportant pieces, right?
Yeah.
And then you get very quickly.
But Doc, someone with your level of experience, you might find something not be important, but it could actually be life-changing experience, life-changing learning for someone else.
And this is really the... Especially my mistakes.
Hopefully we'll get a chance to go through some of those too. But let's start off. I think we'll start off with you started off at IIT Madras, BTech in engineering, and then what was IIT like when you went there?
IIT was really cool. In fact, the one small correction I'd like to make is it's 25 years in corporate life and entrepreneurship and about 7-8 years. So I'm actually 30 plus years in experience, approximately. Okay, so just wanted to kind of let folks know that there was the classic entrepreneurial journey, exec journey, working for companies, and then about 7-8 years, exciting life. And somewhere in between, there were a couple of years of being a prof.
And I think we've got some photographs from your childhood.
This is when I was 1 year old. Dad was an IAS officer. This is actually in Odisha. And we are... Tamrams, Iyengars, so they kind of stuck all this stuff on me and got me to walk.
And did you know, Doc, that you wanted to pursue a degree in engineering? Like, what was there an early bent of mind towards that?
Not really. Actually, the reason I actually chose engineering is because of my maternal granddad, because he actually was a gold medalist from Guindy Engineering College in the old days before IITs. And he actually got his PhD in automobile engineering from University of Michigan. Brilliant guy. And despite my dad's influence to be an IAS officer and my uncle's influence to be an IAS officer, which I got through, didn't take it up and went on to do my MS and PhD in the US. So I have to thank my maternal granddad.
Wow. And I mean, look at the impact that created. You did your PhD at the University of Illinois at Urbana-Champaign in computer info sciences. And again, this was still relatively early in the tech boom, right? This is like pre 90s, 1988, if I'm not wrong. That the year of your PhD? And I mean, it must have been a few handful of you that were pursuing these kind of degrees, because computers were massive and very slow back then.
So actually, it's a slightly different thing, right? I mean, I need to point this out to a lot of people. In fact, the smartest guys I knew were guys who were doing their master's, not PhD. Unfortunately, for us to get a job in the US in those days, we had to overqualify ourselves. And so that was a way to get yourself a permanent residence. What do they call it in the US? Alien resident, which is a green card.
Green card, okay.
Yeah. They call it alien resident, even now. Okay.
They have some really funny nomenclature.
Yeah, and the green card is not really green. It's kind of strange. But in any case, you had to overqualify yourself because there were rules. I mean, rightfully so, that like locals who are smart would get obviously apply for jobs and things like that. So there are two paths open. Go there, do your PhD, become a prof, or go become a researcher. And luckily for me, both my high school, which was Hyderabad Public School, and earlier than that was St. Columbus in Delhi, and IIT Madras, to whom I'm eternally beholden, got me there. And I thought I wanted to be a prof and a teacher. I still do.
And then once you got done with before I get there, actually, these educational experiences, because you had, you know, IIT Madras, still one of the most sought out institutes in India even today, right, for the kind of talent that is coming out. And we've invested in many of these IIT Madras graduate companies, and I mean, there's a different level and different sheen on those on those graduates. I wanted to understand, like, how important has this education that you went through been in your overall entrepreneurial and operational operator journey?
Well, I think IIT was very important. Just like Hyderabad Public School was very important. Like, for example, in school, I actually went, studied with people who became ministers. Mm-hmm. My one-year junior was a guy who was a CEO of Adobe, Shantanu Narayan. We had Ajay Banga from Hyderabad Public School. We have Satya Nadella, mm-hmm. whom you already know. We also have Kiran Kumar Reddy, who was the Chief Minister of Andhra Pradesh. We have Malipuri Raju, who was the Union Minister of MHRD. Okay.
Wow.
There's a photograph that will come up, which is called UIUC, and the guy in the middle is this dude who became the Union Minister in Congress for MHRD. 2009 to 2014. So it was a brilliant exposure at HPS, where we met everyone. And my cricket school captain, I was a good cricketer. My cricket school captain was Saad Bin Jung, who was Nawab of Pataudi's nephew. And wow. We had Vivek Jaisimha, who was ML Jaisimha's son. So it was a brilliant cricket team too. And the funny thing was, none of us actually bothered who we were. And that was a brilliant bonding. I mean, it's a fantastic school that way. And IIT Madras was even better, because in school, I was always like in the top three. You go to IIT and then you get 250 people who have always been in the top three. Then you figure out where do you stand. And it's, I think it's a practical guy who figures out, saying that, boss, these guys are better than me. And in those days, there were no mobile phones or internet or whatever. And so we actually bonded really well. And out of the 244 or 250, I don't remember exactly the number, in our batch, almost 200 people are still in touch, which is fantastic. And the high school is an incredible percentage, almost 95%.
And how are you guys staying in touch?
We are in touch thanks to all the good stuff that happened, man. Tech, like WhatsApp and email and groups.
And I mean, the ability for all of you guys to come together, that is amazing.
We're still in touch, and we like it. I mean, it's brilliant. We keep exchanging information and reminiscing about old times, but you also kind of help out. Like in the COVID times, a lot of us have been getting together and doing whatever we can. Kind of frustrating, but we've been trying to do that.
And have you had a chance to probably go back to IIT Madras, I guess, after in the previous few years?
This is a photograph from University of Illinois, Urbana-Champaign. So there's some interesting things here. The guy in the middle is the guy who became the minister. Okay?
Okay.
Pallam Raju. The guy, you can see me, I'm wearing this gray T-shirt. And we had started a cricket club of Illinois. And the guy to the extreme right is a guy called Kabul Chawla, who's a JEE number 10 in our batch, and went to IIT Kanpur. And then I went to IIT Madras, he went to IIT Kanpur after school, and we became PhD buddies at UIUC. Strange kind of ways people connect us, right? And the guy went on to be a senior dude at Bell Labs. You know my story. And the guy in the middle became a union minister.
Wow. That's an impressive, impressive graduating class right there. And so you went to, and you went to HP after graduating.
Yeah, that was also a very interesting thing because originally I wanted to be a prof. And I got a couple of offers from a couple of universities. And I had, while I was doing my PhD, by the way, I did my PhD in AI, okay, in those days. And I actually got an offer from Dick from the AI TD lab. They had an AI lab. It was all a toy kind of stuff that we were doing. I got an offer from a couple of universities to be an assistant professor. And I got HP labs. And I said, okay, HP looks good. Because I'd actually met my better half. She was also Cornell and HP, IIT Delhi. And then, okay, HP is cool. And plus, we're going to California. And that was the intent. We wanted to move from Illinois, which was like you yourself mentioned earlier when we were talking, very, very cold.
Yep.
And this is actually an early picture of us after we got married. And this is in actually Colorado, because after going to California, we were told to go back to Colorado, and this was for a couple of years. This was in a place called Fort Collins, where we had our first child, daughter, and the water snaps or the vistas up there is a place called Horsetooth Reservoir, and that's Usha and I standing in front of our house.
Wow.
First house that we bought.
And you had a very interesting role. You were like you said. But what was the like an R&D engineer, R&D lead at HP, and HP was one of the most sought out companies at the time. It was going through this entire phase where you're going to become one of the top Fortune 1000 or Fortune 100 companies. What was that like to be inside a tech company in the 90s? In the early
90s. That's very interesting because in those days, I'm talking about, I would say, 80s and 90s, I got a chance to actually interact with Bill Joy, founder of Sun, UC Berkeley. We worked on the BI editor. A lot of people have heard about that. Worked on a lot of source code, configuration management system like RCS and SCCS. HP was great because we wanted to actually build the first visual software engineering development environment on what I call workstations, and HP had actually bought Apollo. So very, very interesting times where we were actually working on key software problems. I mean, we talk about DevOps now, we talk about Atlassian, we talk about Git, we talk about all, those are the kind of things we were solving, right from the compilers to language sensitive editors, debuggers, static analyzers, dynamic analyzers, name it. So a lot of cool stuff.
And then, after HP, and I mean this amazing experience you were having, you had a very interim role at Informic, but you then started a company which I love the name of, by the way. It's called Pretzel Logic Software.
Yeah.
And the first question I had even before why you would leave all of this to start Pretzel is, where did the name Pretzel Logic come from?
Well, it comes from my favorite band called Steely Dan. And Steely Dan is a fantastic group, and this was borrowed from their second album. And after we actually called our company Pretzel Logic, San Jose Mercury News also started to put out a comic strip in California, San Jose, called Pretzel Logic, which is pretty interesting, right? And the whole idea was, when you look at a pretzel, it's very convoluted.
Yeah.
And if you write bad code, it's very convoluted. How do you unconvolute it? And so that was the name. But I think when you get a chance, Anirudh, in fact, all the viewers should actually go back and listen to that album. Listen to the group. Actually, they're a phenomenal group. I mean, I still listen to them right now. And in my mind, they are God.
and what was I guess, the genesis? Like, what was the idea behind Pretzel Logic?
Well, that's a very good question. I mean, while I was actually writing stuff at HP, and then because of all the work that I'd done, Informix had a good database and they had a 4GL language. They wanted me to come and build the language side, which is basically how do you program so that it can actually access the database, I started realizing that people really didn't understand how to build software. So I said, okay, man, I mean, I know how to build it. Let me go actually start a company and teach them how to build software. That was the premise.
And is that what followed for the next 9 years?
That's correct. And I had no idea what VC funding was, even though I was sitting in the valley. And those were early days, obviously. And whom do we have here? Oh, actually, we have Chandra on my left. And try to figure out a very attractive person on my right, but I'm not able to place her. But like, I think it's Andrea, if my memory serves me right, because old days here. I think this was probably at a Christmas party because we used to have this quite often in the US.
I see. And so is this from the time when you were at Pretzel Logic?
This is correct. This is Pretzel Logic. Chandra was a kid who came and actually interned with us, and we accepted him. This is the gentleman left.
Yeah, the one in the white shirt?
Yes, that's correct.
I see. And what was, I know you said that you found the opportunity, but what was the trigger? What was that moment when you decided, you know what, I'm going to drop Informix and these
Well, I was pretty inspired, because once you work in the valley, I mean, there's so many people who built companies, including Bill Hewlett and Dave Packard. I mean, they started in a garage in Stanford. You see all of this stuff happening around you. You see Sun Microsystems, you see Apple. I mean, all these people were accessible to us even those days. They would come and talk to us and say, go do whatever you want. And the US was pretty cool in those days. I mean, yes, you had time. It's very different from now, where everyone's rushing to do things and everyone's closing big checks and raising money. But this was a really good time. I mean, because we got a chance to actually spend a lot of time with these folks and what they were building, what was important to them. So I'm talking about people like Steve Wozniak, Marty Kagan, product management. I'm talking about Bill Joy. I'm talking about Scott McNeely, not from that perspective, but eating a burger with him in Chili's.
Oh, wow.
Or even Vinod Khosla a little bit later, right? Kanwal Reiki, Suhas Patel, all of these guys founded the Thai organization in 1994-95. It was a great time because there was time and you could actually spend time, and they'd also tell you you're full of shit. And you got to accept that, right?
Was there ever a moment where you actually received some advice that was like that was maybe all thought altering?
All the time. I'll tell you, the biggest advice like that always came from my parents.
Acha.
I mean, why will anyone leave a $125,000 job in 1992 and go do your own startup? You're stupid. I think after 6 months, I realized maybe I was stupid, but it turned out okay.
It turned out more than okay. Pretzel was ranked as a top 100 privately held company 3 years in a row, and was part of the Inc. 500, which is a mean feat. Because considering that you started with almost nothing, you didn't really have any pedigree as an entrepreneur before you started, and you made a company that was in the top 100. Even in the 90s, that's a big, big deal. And then later on, I mean, what was that moment like? What were you guys, oh, wow. Is this the party to celebrate the ranking?
Maybe. I mean, actually we used to celebrate a lot. I mean, small things too, because it was very important to keep the team together. And at that particular point in time, I always felt that we had to have a nice blend. So if you look at this picture, in fact, at our peak, we had 150 people, and out of which at least 75, 80 folks were locals. And we only hired locals. And that was very important in those times, because I felt good talent should be nourished and we should be recognized for that. We should contribute to California and the US because it gave me a break. Okay. I never got a break in India. I got a 3,000 rupee job from telco. I'm just kidding. I mean, I've got a lot of bricks in India.
For many of the founders who've not seen a computer.
I've got a lot of bricks in India too. So I'm just kidding.
But you know what? One thing I would say, people keep that photograph. I want to show a computer from the 90s. For many of the millennials have not seen a computer from the 90s. You know, this is what computers used to look like, guys. That big thing over there, that's just the monitor. The CPU is probably below somewhere, right? And on the right is a laptop.
Yeah. I think a lot of people here also may have seen it. My mom still has one of those. She likes it. She feels that's a computer as opposed to a small, lightweight laptop because it is there physically, right?
I mean, today you have an all-in-one that is probably as big as that.
Correct. Yeah, I mean, it's very difficult. I mean, listen, I can actually write code on my mobile, right? If I want to.
Mm-hmm. Correct. Very true. Very, very true. And then moving on, Doc, you acquired by WebGain, right? And then later on that entity was then acquired by Oracle. What was the trigger? Like after 9 years, and being at the top of the pile.
Two or three main triggers. I think one was a big mistake. I think when we got an acquisition to get acquired for 100 mil at that time, which was huge sum of money, we thought we could continue to build. Then the .com bust happened. And that actually gave everyone a haircut, including good companies. And I also had an unfortunate incident with my second child, who was because of an accident, had to go, was misdiagnosed at Stanford, and he became a paraplegic. And we had to send our older daughter to India. And we had very few reserves because you're a young couple living there. And one of the older child is in India living with my parents. I didn't want to kind of make them suffer. Plus, I had spent very little time with my parents because right through my life, I was in boarding school, IIT, out. So whatever we got, we said, like, let's give a decent exit to our investors, folks who stuck by us. And that was basically it at that point.
Who were the investors?
Couple of tier one VCs. We had Samsung and we had Charles River. From Boston, we had like Cambridge Technology Enterprises. Can you give me 2 seconds? I'm sure you'll be able to edit it. I'm just going to get a power supply and check it. I don't know why the power's gone down. Okay.
So while we wait for the doc to come back, I mean, guys, if you have any questions for the doc, and like I said, he's got an amazing background, and you know, somebody who's raised money in the Valley, he's obviously been in India. He's been part of some amazing companies. We'll get through that as well. You should definitely go check out Dr. Srikanth Sundararajan's LinkedIn profile because, like I said, he's got a wealth of experience and somebody who definitely should be a part of your LinkedIn, connects. And in case you guys have any questions, I know some of you guys have already started sharing those questions with me, but in case there are any questions, please feel free, put them in the comment section below and we'll take them up with the doc as we go through the show. In terms of, Doc, are you back? I think we may have lost him for a second there. But yeah, I mean, like I was telling all of you guys that are tuned in, we've got somebody with a wealth of experience over, like you said, over 35 years, somebody with a PhD. He's been working and coding with computers way before computers became so omnipresent in our life. And now he's, also funding companies, right? He's somebody, I think, if I had a tech company, I would love to get an investor like that who would have the kind of Rolodex and the kind of experience that the doc has. And I'm going to take on some more questions once the doc returns. So just feel free, if you guys have any questions, go ahead and ask them through. In terms of think we'll give him a couple of minutes to come back, guys. Just a small technical snafu. By the way, in between Pretzel Logic and HP, you know, the doc is also an R&D manager for a company called Informix from June 1991 to September 1992. Once he comes back, we're going to get a little bit into his Indian experience. He's been a CTO for some very, very exciting companies and some of the companies that most of you guys have also heard the names of. I'm not going to reveal the names right now unless you've seen the doc's profile. You will hear about what he did for those companies and how he's been part of, I think, three major IT firms in India today and the role he's played over there. So we look forward for him to join us back any moment now. Great comment, Rishabh. Thank you. I think you're right. I guess it's not really the question of feeling stupid, right? I read an amazing tweet this morning that says that we would have so much freedom the minute we stop taking things personally, right? So the only person who can think we're stupid or not is you, and you don't need to look for anybody else's validation or anyone else's approval of whatever it is that you're doing. So according to me, you know, you're as smart or as stupid as you think you are. And you know, the only thing you are in control of is the action that are under your control. So only as smart as you think you are. And the only thing you have to do is just show up. And half the battle is won, you need to show up. So meanwhile, guys, if you guys have any questions for me, I'll be happy to answer until we get the doc back. I think there was a power cut where the doc was at, and that's probably why we've lost him. We're trying to get a hold of him. Meanwhile, happy to answer any questions. I think Apoorv, you've asked a question, but we'll wait for the doc to come back because I think the question is directed towards him. But if anybody else has any questions, I know Dushant pointed out that IIT Madras had a big moment today. We had an IIT Madras incubated company called Agnikul, which is in our portfolio of reels. Yeah, hi Doc, how are you? Welcome back. Are we good? Cool. So the Doc, where we were at was, we were asking you about your experience with fundraising back in the 90s from VC funds. Can you hear us?
I'm not able to. Clearly, are you
here? Can you hear us now? Hello? Hello? Can you hear us now?
Yes, I can hear you. Could you repeat the question?
Okay, great. Yeah, no, so we were talking about, raising venture capital in the 90s, right? Before before emails and the internet had overtaken our lives, what was it like raising from all these marquee VC funds and having them on your board?
Well, email was always there. So at least during my time, when I got to the US in 84, email was there. Email address is SRI, because it's like a long name. So it's me college days. And we were also not very sophisticated. And the nice thing was, when we were actually pitching to VCs in those days, they actually had a good problem, which is always a case. We were totally kind of, how should I put it? Motivated, totally focused, you around you, you could articulate whatever you could. I mean, same old stuff, but like maybe you had a little bit more time on your side, because right now you have like 10 guys pitching the same thing. Maybe that was not the pressure in those days.
I see. And probably a much better network effect, because like you said, you know, people were way more accessible back then.
Yeah, I think as far as I'm concerned, I wasn't aware of a VC ecosystem till someone said, like, why do you have to put your own money? There are people willing to actually put money in. And that was actually an eye-opening thing to me. I said, like, I always felt that I had to build a company from scratch, which meant it, don't get me wrong, but like, I think along the way, you realize that you need capital. And you need to take capital in at the right time, and you need to take capital.
And then after that, I believe you came back to India, and you explained the reasons why. Thank you so much for that. And you became a CTO, a VP at HCL Technologies, which at that time was, at least in today's day, you know, in today's parlance, would be still a relatively young company.
Well, they were $200 million. Today they must be about $14-15 billion. The reason I took that up is when I was at HP in the early days in the US, I actually helped them establish their software business, because their hardware business, when they went out to the US, didn't work out because of a lot of FDA regulations and things like that. So they had some really smart guys, a lot of ex-IIT guys and people I know. And so I think it's very important to help them out. And I came back when I was coming back to India for personal reasons, as I told you. I think Shiv said, why don't you come and work here? You like it. And I really enjoyed the 2 years there.
Oh, wow. And then from there, you went to Cognizant, where you were a CTO as well. And from Cognizant
was a very interesting thing, right? People were writing a lot of COBOL and Cognizant in those days. And obviously, I have no clue about COBOL because it was written in the 70s, 80s. It's not as though I didn't know COBOL. But Cognizant was looking for someone who could come in and actually start pushing new stuff like analytics, Java, next generation languages, performance architectures, and things like that. SOAP or web-based architectures. So it was a wonderful experience there to come in and actually transform, or I wouldn't say I transformed it, but I was given the opportunity. I really enjoyed it, worked very closely with Lakshmi and Frank and a little bit of Kumar, because he was actually on the way.
I see.
I did transform it. I think we changed it from basically predominantly software maintenance, outsourcing, COBOL-oriented kind of company to the next generation. We set up about 10 really cool COEs, got them going, just phenomenal, actually. Some of them still exist, and some of them still work there, and some of them still stay in touch with me.
And then I noticed you went to Persistent and worked with Anand in...
Correct. Yeah. Between Persistent and Cognizant, there was a gap, okay? And I wanted to do something. So I said, let me do another startup. And I did a small fintech startup, which got acquired within like 12 months.
Wow.
That hasn't been actually mentioned, but it was more in the enterprise tech finance pre-SaaS kind of product offering for lease management in the fintech space. And that got acquired by Goldman Sachs. And it was so short that I thought I missed something, because we joined it and someone put in 20 million and got acquired for 160 mil. And they said, do you want to come back to Minnesota? I said, no. So that was the end of that journey. And then Anand and I actually started journeys together, because he was also at HP Labs in the old days. And I did Presto, he did Persistent, and he came back to India. And he said, boss, I need someone like you, because you're very hands-on, you're techie, and we do only outsource product development. Will you come and join me? And we want to raise a Series A. I said, fine. I think it looks good. I know you from before. That's all I needed. It was a brilliant journey. We took that company from about $20-25 million in revenue, $200 million, went public. I always wanted to do that because that's a very important journey for all entrepreneurs. And he's a great guy. He's still a great friend. And I hope they do well. I'm still a shareholder there. Like I'm still and cognizant. So I never let go of my shares.
Wow. I can only imagine the compounding. No, it's so interesting. I just realized I made my first angel investment in February of 2012. And you, I think you ended your association at Persistent in March of 2012. In between, you had set up and sold two companies. You had an acquisition with Goldman Sachs. You've been, you know, obviously had ESOPs with three major Indian IT companies. I mean, that it must have been like, there must be so much information up there, right?
Yeah, how do you... There still is. That's the beauty of life, right? I mean, the reason I took a break in 2012 and actually taught at IIT was actually to give back to IITians, young IIT kids, also learn from them because these guys are pretty smart. And happened there.
Yeah, IIT you were the professor for computer science at IIT Bhubaneswar.
That's correct. The reason I went there was my dad actually had a stroke. He retired as the chief secretary of Orissa. And a good buddy of mine was setting up IIT Bhubaneswar as a director. He said, like, man, you're the best qualified guy here. You're doing nothing because I want to take time off. And so I said, fine. I'd spent two years doing that. It was fun. And I treated it almost like a startup because I wanted the kids to learn, enjoy. And I'm very happy that I could actually touch 400 kids that way. And probably about 40 profs because... Once I started teaching, a lot of profs from other colleges actually used to come and audit my lectures, and then they wanted me to actually teach them how to teach kids. So that was very nice, actually.
That was really interesting. I mean, such amazing stories. And you were also, I think, in between a venture partner for Helion as well.
That's correct. So right. that was a very interesting thing. I know Ashish from the old days because in the 1990s, there were all of us kids like Vani Kola, who was a very famous person here. She, me, Ashish, all of us are doing our first startups in different ways. We used to go attend these Thai meetings and all that. Ashish is a great, great friend. He still is a good friend. Respect him a lot. And when he said, like, hey, why don't you come and join? I said, like, I don't know what a venture capitalist is. Can I actually do a bit of both? Because I'm pretty good at building things out. And so he said, like, take a venture partner role and then figure out what happens after that. So that was a great opportunity. I got to see a lot of startups, also brought in a couple of startups, help them build out. I'm very, very happy that I met some really cool founders. That was an A-class team, I'm telling you. Helion probably in today's VC situation, I think that was a really A-class team. A-class in the sense.
I was growing up in my investment career and Helion was the one fund you wanted, you know, on board, I think. Like you said, it was right there, Helion, Kalari, all of the world. Like these were the funds you wanted your funds to, your startups to have as, you know, have them on the cap table. So definitely, I mean, completely agree with you. These are amazing, amazing funds, even great names even today. And you know, even when Helion's partners have moved out and set up stuff, you know, they obviously are banking on the excellent work.
It was a brilliant team, right from... the investment managers, the senior partners like Kaval, Sanjeev, Ashish, Rahul. Rahul is still probably there at Helion right now. Then we had this Alok. Alok actually joined around the time I did. He's actually Alok, Ritesh, and Rahul started their own very cool fund, very, very good fund called Stellaris. I actually kind of hung out in no man's land for a few months before I got drawn back to the IIDM alumnus and VenturEast, which is where I am right now. But it was actually a very brilliant fund, Helion. It taught me a lot in a short time in the context of India. I always knew venture capital stuff in the US, but India was very good learning.
And again, like I said, it was a very important fund in bringing us to where we are today. I also noticed on your LinkedIn profile that you were also an executive coach and mentor, which is a very interesting role. I think you were...
So that I still am, no? I know that I can also do that for you. Okay.
I mean, I was about to ask you, like, what would it take to get you on as an executive coach?
So it's actually, it started way back in the 1990s when Pretzel was doing fairly well. And a lot of people used to come and say, how are you doing and what are you doing? I said, I don't have any magic formula. I used to leave Saturday, Sunday open. And quite often, Usha would get pissed off because a whole bunch of guys at home drinking beer from the fridge and fooling around. And these were guys who wanted to be startup guys. And we used to have very, very good conversations. And that continued on in India too. In fact, when I was at Helion, Saturday, Sunday was open. And it still is here, of course, with lockdown and all. I have to go to a particular place in a particular time and do it in a very, very time-confined manner. But otherwise, the house is always open for these kids to come and have a chat.
So if somebody wanted to reach out and get you to mentor them, what would be the playbook? What should be their playbook, rather?
Nothing, just reach out. I mean, if it's a bad idea, I'll tell them it's a bad idea, come back. And then we'll sit down and talk. And at the end of the day, even I have 100 ideas, right? I'm pretty confident about 70-80% of them are pretty useless. And I'm telling you, I've actually told people, don't do this. And they've come back after 2-3 years and said, what you said was right. And there, that is the actual thing, right? I mean, it's not about discouraging people. It's just about telling them, this is not right. This is not the right time for you.
In fact, it brings us to the first audience question that we already have. It's a question from Apur Malpani. He asks, what's the few thumb rules you follow, sir, in making any decision? Because it just flows with what you were saying.
Okay. So there are two distinct kind of decision making that I'm going to tell you. If you are an entrepreneur, I think always think about your company first. Don't think emotionally. Be a little bit dispassionate, okay? And make sure that you're doing everything for your company, everything for your investors, okay? Obviously, employees, right? So consider all of that. So don't just react. Because if you react, it's not a good thing. You might have competition. You might have all this press putting out articles about people who you think are doing better than you. At the end of the day, just focus on value. If you're an investor, it's a different thing because you have all the time, people are coming to you because you have the money, in which case you have a lot of data. And how do you distill it and make that right decision? And still you'll make mistakes. So there, I think one of the things is it's okay to miss a couple of good deals, but never get into a couple of bad deals.
That's so true. And I think also if you've got into a bad deal, try to get out of it as quickly as possible.
It's very tough. It's very tough. That's why I keep trying to tell entrepreneurs, you know what? At the end of the day, you're building value for yourself, for your employees, for your shareholders. So be very, very transparent in terms of your relationship. Obviously, you're already doing well. You already have a good relationship with your customers. You have a good product, right? If you don't, that's an earlier stage situation. But never ignore all the segments, right? And never ignore proper governance in your company. I mean, Anirudh, you'll understand. If someone is actually kind of embezzling money or putting out wrong numbers or actually talking to other co-investors, putting out different, it's actually bad for the ecosystem. Don't do that.
Very true. And there should be zero tolerance for that kind of behavior any which ways. I mean, whether you're an investor...
Sometimes what happens is it's circumstantial, right? Even then, take a step back. You may make a mistake, but it's okay to put your hand up and say, I made a mistake. Okay? I'm not talking about embezzlement and all that. You might make a bad decision. You might sign up a bad partnership, which might be... I don't think people are going to be unhappy because you made a mistake genuinely, right? In the interest of the company, right? You might have been hasty, but people take things like corporate governance, financial embezzlement, transparency to your investors very, very seriously.
And at least I know for us, and I know for almost, I would say, all investors out there, any issue with this or any question mark on that is going to pretty much tarnish your image for the rest of your life. And that reputation
does. But the worst thing is it tarnishes your investor even more, because see, as a venture capitalist or an investor, you know that it's not our money, right? We put a little bit of our money, and then everyone invests in us, and they trust us to make the right choices. And if we make a mistake and put it in a company where corporate governance is really poor, that reflects on us.
Absolutely.
Fine, we might make an investment and things may not work out. That's a different thing for circumstantial reasons, because sometimes the going is tough. Yep. Sometimes the situation is tough, right? But like, at least the entrepreneur is up front, great guy, because we do introduce them to ILPs, right? They also have some kind of a feel. But if you're blatantly ignoring that, and there are good examples here, good examples in the US also, those are the two ecosystems I know, it's not good.
Yeah. No, completely agree. In fact, it's such a valuable lesson, even for, and all the founders that are listening in, and I know lots of questions are coming in from there. That's one area that you cannot be. It has to always be in the white. You cannot be in the black or the gray. Don't even think about it. Like, you'd rather just let things go.
So I'll give you an example, right? I mean, the first few years of my first company, I didn't even pay myself a salary, okay? And I used to kind of also make sure that any extra dollar spent was done properly. If you're taking a customer out, obviously do that and make sure that if you're traveling, I used to send people out on what we call all-nighters, right? All-nighters, or whatever they call it, red-eye flight. I used to say, get on the plane from California, show up in Boston in the morning. But I would always say, you know what, that is tough on your body. Make sure you stay in a nice place. Make sure you take your customer out. Make sure everything is fine. That's all okay. Okay, you're not doing anything wrong. But falsifying expenses, misusing credit cards, kind of writing out monies to a fake company, lots of this stuff happens, which is not right.
So true. And after that, I mean, after Helion, you've also been an advisor and a mentor to multiple different startups. So just going through some of the name, Affen Analytics, Enterprise Force, NextGen, Aether Energy, very interesting company there as well. Team Indus, 34th Cross, Bounty. You've also been investing personally.
The way it happens here is during my time before joining Helion, I was free. At Helion, as a venture partner, I could actually take permission and invest if Helion was not interested. So I did that. Between Helion and VenturEast, I was free. So I did a few angel investments. So those are all those things. And the other things are more from they came to me, I spent time. If you look at 34th Cross, is actually Hasura.io today.
What's that?
You already know Get Postman. You already know Aether, okay? So all these were companies which came to me fairly young and looking for inputs and help out. In fact, DocsApp was an investment, okay, which is MediBuddy today.
Mm-hmm.
AI Bono is an ag tech startup, which is an investment which is doing fairly well. What's the other one? I mean, there's a bunch of really cool startups, right? Which happened.
And I'm noticing a theme. Time. It's a very, very strong enterprise, SaaS or B2B SaaS theme out there that you're
interested in. That's all I know. I don't know too much about lipsticks or makeup or shoes. But you know what? Funnily enough, I've actually been associated with some phenomenal women entrepreneurs. So Sugar Cosmetics, Vinita Singh, Junior from IIT Madras, then Munro Shoes and Apparel, Pina Asia, then Aarti Gill, Ozaiva, which is basically more about nutraceuticals, then Anaya Sagi, Baby Chakra.
Baby Chakra. I'm an investor in Baby Chakra, by the
way. So they've all come and spent time. I mean, more from a different perspective. As I told you, I don't know lipstick. I don't. They'll give me stuff which I will use happily, like a body wash, or I don't use lipsticks. But I'm just saying. Phenomenal. But during Helion, I actually did spend some time with Kamal. Kamal is a great guy, as far as D2C. And so we did vote on a couple of really cool companies like Big Basket and ID Fresh, and they're doing phenomenally well today also.
Yeah, so the question that came to me, and you know, while I was putting together the flow and doing the research. Your background, you joined VenturEast in 2017. This was VenturEast is a 1997 fund, right? And I looking at your experience, looking at your track record, I mean, you could have set up your own fund, but you chose VenturEast. So what was that decision? What attracted you to VenturEast?
It's a very good question. Mainly because of personal reason. Because see, you are getting old. Number one, mm-hmm. And raising a fund is not that easy. A lot of people think a VC's job is very cool, right? You have to actually go and establish LP relationships, and it takes probably about almost 2 years. If you look at the Stellaris guys, they actually spent at least 12 to 18 months on the road, and they were all in their late 30s, early 40s, so it was a good time to do that. I was probably in my second half of 50s, right? and it is tough. And the nice thing is I knew VenturEast guys from before. I have a long association with them because they actually went to the same high school I went to, and they also went to IIT Madras. So very, very good bond. In fact, when I sold my first company, Raghu Mendu, who was one of the founders of VenturEast, actually helped me. This is Pretzel. Wow. So it's a long relationship. And I took a deliberate decision saying that, yeah, it'll be good to work with them and help them, because see, the one thing that they were missing was they were missing a really hands-on techie guy, because I still look at code, I still kind of, and the enterprise SaaS thing was missing, and that's what I like to do. I mean, you already know that, and so it became a much easier decision, and spent some time with the LPs, and they like me, I like them, and that was it. Starting a new fund was very far from my mind at that point. I might have actually gone back and become a prof and written a couple of books, which I'm doing right now. I'm writing one book. And I may still become a prof in about a couple of years. But in the sense, I'll only teach maybe a few days in a year, only on certain algos, which I like.
can people come and audit the class?
Yeah, absolutely. Everyone's welcome. Everyone should be welcome, because while teaching, I still learn, which is good.
And what's the best way to get into these classes? I think a lot of entrepreneurs would love to join, including myself.
So actually, the last 3 years, apart from COVID, was actually bad. But like 2017, 2018, 2019, I used to actually teach a course called Digital Entrepreneurship with profs at ISB. You've probably heard of ISB, right?
Yeah.
In the School of Business. And so I worked with Deepa Mani and a professor called Anand, and we used to actually pick up six companies that I like.
I see.
And they would come in and work with 30 MBA students, five assigned to each company, and we solved real world problems. They'd actually go to the companies and solve things.
Wow. And these were startups, or these were
they were all startups. They all are doing well. All of them gained. There were three batches, so I would say about 17, 18 companies. Last year was bad because of COVID. Everything went all right. And this year, I'm also very demotivated because of all the chaos. And I understand that they can't organize it, because it becomes very tough if you don't interact with people, go to their place, see what's happening, right?
I really like this idea. I think post-episode, would love to, like when we catch up next week, as we're talking about, would love to explore this. Especially, I mean, I can think of at least three startups that would really stand to gain, and even the students would love to
That was the intent to actually get things fired up and And a lot of those kids who, MBA kids, actually ended up working for startups because they appreciated what was going on. The startups also actually learned a lot. Their hiring became okay. They kind of started valuing inputs. They've all done fairly well. In fact, all of them have actually gone to the next level. I think about 50% raised the next round. All good.
Wow. That's a big hit rate. So right now, you're part of the investment team. I think you're focusing, like, your personal investments on enterprise tech and SaaS. If you were a founder and you were applying to VenturEast and you wanted, you know, the doc to invest, what would be the top three things that they should be highlighting to you about themselves or their ventures?
Well, I think solve a big problem. Okay. Solve it in such a way that you're leveraging technology in a very smart manner. India is a great place to solve for certain things, like, for example, education, healthcare, logistics. Logistics has not been solved still, in my opinion. Mm-hmm. It can be done really well. Of course, with logistics, there are issues with regulations, right? It's always the case. Healthcare, again, regulations. Now I'm talking to a couple of companies. In fact, Professor Satya Chakravarti out of IIT Madras, mm-hmm. We've actually helped him through. He's a pretty close friend of mine. He's done Agnicool. He's done E-Plane. Agnicool is recently raised. It's happening in India, right? So that's, again, a great thing. EV technology, batteries, another great place to actually look at. And alternate energy is still a little bit away. Half the problem with India is basically the government themselves. They need to actually start opening up their mind, involving really young blood to actually take the whole thing forward. It's okay to put some money, but if you have the old style decision making, it becomes mm-hmm. tough.
True.
So I think all of that are very good areas to focus on, even now. Even agri-tech, India needs a lot of that.
And usually, at what stage are you coming into
so VenturEast comes in typically pre-series A, series A, series B. That's basically our mm-hmm. bracket. And typically, we'd want, in this fund at least, we'd want at least one good co-investor, because it always helps the entrepreneur also. Because if you have two funds backing the entrepreneur, one yeah. of the funds may end their cycle, the other person may still have money to put it. So that's always good.
True.
And that way, you don't get limited. Because I have only $5 to put in, I put in all my $5, where are you going to get raise the next thing? If like two of us put in three each, I may have one more to put in, he might have five more to put in. So we can actually kind of fill it out.
Makes sense. And what would be the decision-making timeline when somebody applies? Like, what's the, how quickly can you guys turn around with the decision?
Could you repeat that, Anirudh?
What's the decision-making timeline when someone applies? Let's say someone reaches out to you, wants you to invest in their company.
Okay, I got to be upfront. If I were to compare VenturEast with Helion was a lot faster. VenturEast is a little bit slower. I mean, that differs from fund to fund because it's basically, how should I put it? Working for a venture fund is actually getting married, right? And so you take the good with the bad. The bad may be sometimes people take a little more time. And the good is they're more deliberate and you don't make mistakes. So I can't put a timeline, but if you were to ask me the same question, Helion would probably take, say, 6 weeks. VenturEast might take 12 weeks.
12 weeks, okay. From the time they meet till the time they put in the money.
Right.
Oh, that's it. And I think 12 weeks is a good timeline. I don't think it's...
Yeah, 12 weeks, might become 14 weeks. Then people are unhappy, right?
And so is there any companies or what are the top three companies you're excited in the current portfolio or the up?
I think I'm very bullish. Again, I go back to enterprise SaaS. I'm very bullish about MoEngage. That's basically doing fairly well. I think they will actually get to some decent stage. I'm also very, very happy about IndusOS. And you might have actually seen a news that PhonePe may be looking at it. Okay.
Yep.
They're a great company, good guys from IIT Bombay. And Ekin Care, which is a digital healthcare platform. They're doing well.
I love that space, by the way. Ekincare space. They were in our competitive analysis.
You should take a look at these guys if you got the money, because you always say, show me the money. So.
No, I mean, Ekincare came in a competitive analysis on another deal that we're doing.
No, they're good guys. They're good guys. And the nice thing about them is they're building value. They're not actually going for massive fundraisers or PR. They're actually building out. The guy is operationally sound. And he's an old school entrepreneur in some ways. He's a lot younger, but like he is very bottom line oriented, spends very carefully, which is good.
So, Doc, what would be a good way for founders to reach out to VenturEast or reach out to you to at least evaluate the ventures?
Just send me an email.
Srikanth, is that Srikanth at VenturEast?
No. It's S-R-I-K. Remember I told you my name got truncated in 1984. It's still truncated. S-R-I-K at VenturEast.net.
Net.
And VenturEast is spelled with an E, one E, not two E's.
I'll ask the team to put that banner up, please. Doc, there's a lot of questions coming in from the audience. I'm going to take a couple, and then we'll move to, because we're already over an hour.
Sure.
So I'll take a couple of questions, and then we'll move to the rapid fire. So that's it, guys. Quickly take a screenshot. It's S-R-I-K at VenturEast.net. That's the best way to reach the Doc. I think the question, this is a follow-on to Apoor had asked this question earlier, like discouraging people and informing them, there's a very thin line of difference. What do you feel is the best path, being direct and short, or giving an explanation or a longer answer when you're giving them the feedback?
So it depends. Actually, there are some people who like direct feedback. I also like giving direct feedback. And if they can accept it, that's the best, because they understand it, right? And go away. There's some people you have to spend a little bit more time. Maybe it's like one or two conversations and they get it. It's going on for too long. Something is wrong, either with me or with them.
And I think this is a very interesting observation over here. I think Rahul Kanugati says that you should share about walk and talk with Doc. His mentoring sessions do a lot for founders.
A lot of people don't know that I had actually a stroke on October 31st last year, where my entire left side was paralyzed. Oh. And so I had to get up and start walking again from scratch. It's very, very difficult, right? So I started walking. And I started walking in this particular place. That time the lockdown was not there. It's there now, but I've set my times. And anyone who wanted to come and talk to me, I'd say, don't talk to me on the phone or Zoom or do anything. Come and walk with me if you can. I'm talking about local guys in Hyderabad. And so it became walk the talk with Doc. And we kept going round and round. And they'd ask me a lot of questions. It was good for me because I was walking and they were walking. And it actually helped me revive myself, because without actually being able to move your left hand, left fingers, left leg, and now being able to run, it's actually phenomenal. So I must thank them for actually doing
that. Doc, I must tell you, this entire, I know I'm the one conducting the interview, but I'm telling you, I'm the one in awe of, your tenacity. You know, the knowledge is immense, but your willpower is at another level.
But that's what I tell entrepreneurs. Even I tell this kid called Rahul, he's doing phenomenally well. He should talk to you. You guys have already met each other 2 years ago. You should meet again, right? Tenacity and basically being humble, being grounded, doesn't matter. I mean, money is money, right? It'll come and go, right?
True.
But if you can contribute to the ecosystem in any small way, contribute to your students in any small way, contribute to people who work with you, you work for, it's always good.
So true. And I think in the true sense, eventually it's what you put out in the world, right? Not what you receive. And that's what leaves a mark. And you're an example for all of us to follow. I mean, we're 20 years your junior, 25 years into
so here are the small requests I have. Am I actually going to be writing a small chronicle about evolution of SaaS? I will put it out tomorrow. Okay.
Okay.
I want to send it to you. Please share it near and far and wide.
Done.
Okay.
Would it be okay if I wrote about it on my blog?
Very cool. You'll like it.
And is it okay if I put it out on my blog, like as a repost?
Please do. Absolutely. Okay. I want it to go out because it's more like history. People understand what happened in the 80s, 90s, early 2000, and up until now, right?
Would love to. And enterprise SaaS is a major part of my portfolio, and we'll talk about it more offline. But as of now, guys, please continue to ask your question, but I am going to take the doc for the rapid fire. Doc, rapid fire, simple rules. I'll ask about 10 to 15 questions. Whatever first comes to mind, you need to answer them right away. This is the part of the, there's no flow here. I'm just going to pick out questions that, you know, that we put together. We've got about 20, but I'll pick about 10 to 15. And then anything interesting comes up, we'll get a little deeper into it. Is that okay?
Sure. Sounds good.
So we'll start with the first question. And I think this is the Peter Thiel question. So one thing that you know to be true, but very few people agree with you on this.
Being upfront.
I would imagine, you know, you're right. Actually, people will say you should be upfront, but very, very few people actually want to be upfront. So it's a very, very just answer. When you hear, what's the first name that comes to your mind when you hear the words successful entrepreneur? What's the first name that comes to mind?
I think Steve Jobs.
And why Steve Jobs?
Because I think he had passion and actually veered. He's actually tried a bunch of things which actually failed. So if I were to compare Steve Jobs and even Bill Gates, Steve was always consumed, always doing the right thing. So I think he'd probably be my consummate entrepreneur.
I also feel he took a lot more shots, right? He took a lot more shots at the net. And, you know, like you said, maybe not all of them worked out, but he definitely took a lot more shots. And whichever one got through was definitely an outlier. Doc, I'm guessing, I mean, this answer should just say it's me, as in you. But I would still ask the question, who's your favorite superhero? And why? I mean, I would say Doc, but.
That's a very, very interesting question. I think it's a very interesting question. My superhero is a gentleman called Gundappa Vishwanath.
Oh.
Because I'm a cricketer. And despite achieving everything, if you meet him, he's still so freaking humble and so approachable.
So to tell you the truth, I've actually hung out with Gundappa Vishwanath in California for about 2 weeks in 1998, my first trip to the US. I was with him. Amazing. Such a down-to-earth person. Considering the legacy that this person, Gundappa Vishwanath has, he was he was amazing.
And you know what? You could also take down his... mobile number 98450-222.
We'll take it offline. We're online right now.
No, I'll tell you why. Because two of his brilliant innings happened in Chepauk, Chennai.
Mm-hmm.
Innings of 222 against England and innings of 97 not out against the West Indies.
Wow.
97-475. So I'm an avid cricketer and now I can't play that much, but he's someone who, to me, I mean, no matter what happened to him, right? When he walked in, he was he. And when he walked out, he was he. Nothing changed.
And getting the ball through the slips, I mean, that was an art form that he made. Do you have any favorite failure?
Favorite?
Failure. Your favorite failure.
Many. The very first thing was I thought I'll outsource my payroll when I was doing Pretzel. I outsourced it to a very famous bank, which was also one of my first customers called Wells Fargo. And I come in the next morning
and there's no money in the bank. And I said, what the hell happened? Because, I mean, we were not paying ourselves salary. Employees are getting salaries. Then someone said, Srikanth, did you give us a bonus? I said, no. He showed me the paycheck. It was 3x what he was supposed to get. So I called them. And they've given everyone 3x. And there's very little in the bank. Okay? And that made me realize, don't blindly go for something which is sexy because it's sold to you.
Yeah.
That could have been a disaster, actually.
Oh, yeah.
And luckily, we had salary accounts in Wells Fargo, so we could actually recall the money.
Oh, wow. Oh, man. And this is, obviously, this is...
Don't tell Wells Fargo. I still back with them.
And then let's see, one piece of advice to founders about fundraising.
So I think it's difficult. I think it depends on what stage you are. But like the key thing I tell people is don't oversell. Okay. Sometimes you get lucky, which is fine. But I think just build value. And try to meet venture capitalists who understand your business, at least have done some investment in that same area. Mm-hmm. So I think when you actually present to them, they're able to understand, whether it's enterprise SaaS or logistics or healthcare. They understand friction. They understand how you're trying to grow the business. They feel they can contribute. All of this helps, okay? But if you oversell and you want to emulate someone else in some other domain, that really doesn't help. Because what happens is you're always trying to pitch. And when you're always trying to pitch for the wrong reasons, you'll always change your pitch. When you keep changing your pitch to the same 40 potential investors, they'll say, this guy is not consistent. It's a very, very small community. So I think it's very important to not forget that.
And I think that's the key, right? That, remember that that's a very small community. Everybody talks to everybody.
That's correct.
And
that's correct.
So if you're pitching two different ideas to two different people,
even if I don't invest, there'll be a buddy of mine who's investing. He'll pick up the phone and say, what do you think about this? Right? I'm not saying it happens all the time, but it happens quite often.
Yeah, and you'd be surprised. And how I mean, even it's happened to me a couple of times. I was so excited about reading about something or someone who gave it to me, what they explained, I was super excited about. And then the entrepreneur came and pitched something so different. Right, that it completely just floored. I mean it just takes your mood off, right? And ended up not investing because could not understand what he was actually doing.
Right. Exactly. I think the key thing is believe in what you're building, believe in value, make sure your numbers are right, make sure you're not bullshitting unnecessarily. Yeah. Because everyone talks about AI machine learning. You come and talk about AI machine learning to me, first thing I'll say, show me the code. The guy will run off.
So
I want to see which guy is going to come and show me that, even today.
One thing you would like to change about the Indian startup ecosystem?
Well, I think it's getting better and better and better. Dampening effect is from the government because they always talk about Startup India, Make in India, all that. But somehow the people who are making decisions there need to become much more attuned to all the challenges that a startup faces, right? You know, Anirudh, if I were to kind of go to a bank and say, give me some cash, right? Credit.
Yeah.
I have accounts receivable. Bank will not give you money. At the same time, that Nirav Modi will take 3,000 crores and pick off, right? All this guy is asking for is 50 lakhs.
Yeah.
And you make it so difficult, despite giving these certificates, Make in India, Startup India, I think they need to kind of go and revisit that for sure. The second thing is the startup fund. You have SIDBI, you have CanBank, but who are the people making decisions? Are they really empowered? They're not. It goes back to the same old guys who are saying, you know what, they have to invest in these kind of companies. They have to do this. Okay, if they take 10 bucks from us, 25 invest in these kind of companies. It doesn't work like that. You have to give them some freedom. And they're not thinking about it. For example, this whole thing about COVID, right? What is the issue there? Forget about the fact that we don't have vaccines, right? But we could have taken care of logistics. We could have taken care of basic healthcare infrastructure. There were companies willing to do that, but they were never empowered. Now you wake up and say, we want this, we want that. It's not going to happen, right? And build that out.
True.
I mean, good countries build that out because that's what is tomorrow.
Yep.
Whether it's telemedicine, whether it's consulting, whether it's like leveraging technology, whether it's building AI machine learning models to kind of diagnose. Because India is vast. Healthcare is a huge, huge area. And yet you have to fill like 20 forms to go and get a vaccine. That too, you may miss it. Like I missed mine. I've given up on the vaccine because my second shot got canceled. So I say, good luck. I'll wait. I'll do it again because I don't jump queues. I don't use special favors. And I got screwed between below 60, greater than 45, less than 18, all that nonsense. Over. It's fine.
But hopefully, Doc, you should get, I mean, we look forward to it. I would really request you to get the second one as soon as you can.
No, I can't get the second one. I have to do a repeat. I have a reset.
Oh, I see.
Because it was Covaxin. It's expired. It's fine. I don't have an issue. I mean, I keep myself safe when it's available. But right now, it's for 18 to 45, which is what they should have targeted if they had sense. But they don't. They never do. That's why I keep doing this.
You're right. I mean, the role of the government... I think the government. We'll talk about that offline, though. But
offline. I think there are a lot of good guys, good people, good intentions, but somehow it never comes together because I think inherently India is large, and solving for a large situation has to be done by younger people because they're there, right?
Yeah.
Like, for example, through 2020 and 2021, it's people like the GoFlitters, the Swiggies, the Dunzos, even Zomato, Big Basket, Farm Easy, they're there. But you trouble the same kids who are coming and delivering with all these lockdown policies.
Yeah, and I mean, it's been one thing after the other, like you said, right? It's really put out.
Things they could have been smart about, but at least right now, you know, this is a vital thing, right? These guys are carrying stuff. They actually enable lockdown by, I mean, if they have been empowered, let them go. Vaccinate them, no, first.
Hmm. And they're the ones going from house to house. So they are the super spreaders, actually, once they get it.
The doodhwalas who bring you milk in the morning.
True, yeah. All those, what I would say, public service workers, right? That actually were doing public service, public good. They should have got it first.
Just a friend of mine who's 45 years old. He said, "I jumped the queue." I said, "I'm not going to talk to you for 1 year."
What company? Let's see. And this is going to be a very interesting answer. I'm looking forward to one piece of advice you would give your 18-year-old self.
18-year-old self, have a little bit more fun. I think I was a little bit more restrained.
Have a little bit more fun. Okay. What are two things that are still left in your bucket list?
Well, I think I need to do a couple of books, okay, which I'm working on. And one of them needs to be converted into a series which can actually live, just like what we are doing today. And hopefully, I mean, good things will come out of that. Nothing for myself. I mean, if I can leave something behind which people can actually reference and it'll be useful for them in the future, that's all. Nothing more.
Let's see. What's the worst? And I was thinking of this question when you were talking about the valley in the 90s, but what's the worst piece of advice you have ever received?
Worst piece of advice? Don't do a PhD.
Don't do a PhD. Oh, wow. and that was such a rare thing back then. So
that's from my dad, because he wanted me to be an IAS officer.
Ah, I see. Okay. What company in your anti-portfolio hurts you the most? A company you should have invested in but did not?
In VenturEast anti-portfolio?
No, your anti-portfolio. Is there any company that you was offered to you, you did not invest? It's in your
Several.
If I look at Helion, we and VenturEast, both of us saw Flipkart early, didn't understand it. I think we also saw ShopClues. Helion did it, VenturEast did not. Several. I mean, I can keep on going.
Is there one that hurts you the most? That really rankles.
I think Postman hurts me the most because I loved it. I brought it to VenturEast. It didn't happen. They're doing really well. Okay. Similarly, there are at least three or four good ones. Like, for example, I was in the US and DoorDash came to me. Okay.
Oh, wow.
And I suggested it to both Helion and VenturEast. Both of them said, what is this DoorDash? And then 3 years later, there was Swiggy. Swiggy came to Helion. Helion said, what is Swiggy? Right? So things happen, right?
No, true. True. We all have ours. So last question. Three books that you would recommend to all the founders who are listening in.
Three books. Okay. This is actually really tough because I like reading and I like reading a lot. But I'll turn this question around and talk about three authors, if that's okay.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's fine. That's great.
So the very first author, which I've always loved, is a gentleman called James Michener. He writes about regions and he writes about fiction and fact together. So, for example, he'll write about the Caribbean, he'll write about the early days in the Middle East, or he'll write about the Caribbean or Hawaii. I mean, very, very nice reading, right? So that's one, right? The other author I really loved was Irving Stone. Irving Stone would write about really cool guys like Michelangelo or Da Vinci, or someone who was a great scientist, right? And in terms of what went on, right? So rather than one guy writing about something, I think Irving Stone is a really, really
very interesting
good author. And then I like, if you want me to talk about humor, okay? And improving English and how you talk or speak, it may be a little bit kind of stoic to an extent. Mm-hmm. I like P.G. Wodehouse.
P.G. Wodehouse.
P.G. Wodehouse. I mean, it's a little bit of a throwback, a little bit more, as they say, British. It's very antiquated British, but I think you'll like it.
So those three books, James Michener, was it right?
Michener. And Irving Stone, Stone, and P.G. Wodehouse, Wodehouse, House.
There we go. So, guys, I mean, I'm definitely picking up one of these books this weekend, finishing at least one of them.
Yeah, I think pick the first two because P.G. Wodehouse is a little bit more cultivated. You have to read 2-3 of them before you start to enjoy the humor. Unfortunately, I come from the old school, so it's easier for me to pick that up.
So, Doc, with that, we end rapid fire. I know there's a lot of questions people are still asking, but unfortunately, we're 25 minutes over, and I've been getting messages from the team that, listen, you know, people need to sleep. But Doc, I really am super, super excited about this episode. I'm super excited about having a chance to catch up with you. And I mean, I look forward to, like I said, having a conversation with you even offline and learning a lot.
Yeah. I'll be very happy to actually do one more session whenever you want to, which is a little bit more specific with you. We can actually kind of make it more tailored. And again, I thank you all for a kind of listening to this old fuddy-duddy or whatever you might call it. And thank Anirudh for having me on his show. And I'm available. You have my email address. And generally, what gets me going is young folks who are doing some cool stuff.
Definitely. Thank you so much, Doc. Have a great night. Great night, everybody. We'll see you again next week with another entrepreneur, with another great story. Thank you so much. Good night.
Thank you.